Well, not that one up there, but this one down here.
I think I've finally gotten used to it.
Used to what?
Your powers. I think I finally got a handle on them in a way that feels right.
That's good. Hopefully you won't faint anymore.
Yeah, and I'll keep learning too. I hope we can make this work out.
Yeah, definitely. Fingers crossed. What's wrong?
Nothing.
Hey! When you and Eleanor made your pact together, she gave you a true name, right? Was it a good one?
True name? What's that?
It's a special name in the ancient tongue given to a Moloch as a necessary step in forming a pact with a human. I gave Bienfu the name Fushi Cass. It means thing.
That's pretty messed up.
It's just my own little way of showing affection.
So what kind of name did you get, Lafayette? What's the matter? She didn't give you a really weird name like Mogulu gave Bienfu, did she? If you're not happy with it, I can talk to Eleanor about it later. So go on and tell me.
I'm fine with it. And I can't tell you anyway.
Well, you don't have to get so worked up about it.
A true name is not something a Moloch just casually divulges to others. They carry a special meaning to us. Speaking it to anyone other than our Pact Keeper carries a special meaning. Between comrades, it means we trust them with our lives. In other cases, it's
practically a confession of love!
You could have said something sooner, you know.
Lafayette's at a delicate age. You should be more careful in the future.
Oh, really? It's just another way of showing affection.
Jacketless outfit for Lafayette 2.0. All right, let's see what it is. This sucks too. Man. Oh, so the only difference is just that. Whatever, you can keep the collar on. Hey, they finally let us go through. Thanks, guys.
Be the demon Tabitha wanted us to know about.
It's flying free, but could it still be a Therian?
I just felt an Earth Pulse point. It's that way, somewhere near the top of that mountain.
Let's check it out.
Land of Light Tower. This is like a dragon base. Ooh, an arcane bottle. Well, come on then. Why are you running away from me?
A foe worth killing.
Weak to fire, but resistant to earth and wind.
Chilling flash! But on this close, I won't miss! Form zero! Form one!
Oh, shit. Oh no, Velvet's dead. I'm just gonna take this. Okay, and the Rokuro is now dead as well. Alright, okay. Alright, you're gonna leave Lopsed alone. Baby. I should be dead like right about now. Okay, there we go. Alright.
It was a close one, but I am the victor.
I wonder if I can go around this, like purposely, like skip this section to go over to this side quest over here.
I can't wait to take a good look around. Whoa, now that's what I call a view.
I agree that it's beautiful, but don't leap about so much. You'll fall.
I can sense many earth pulses under this place.
I figured you'd notice that. An intricate web of earth pulses crisscrosses the land under the Aldina Plains. Mountains like these would normally take tens of thousands of years to form, but these popped up in about a millennia.
So the earth pulses have affected the land?
Exactly. Long ago, people wielded arts that allowed them to manipulate the earth pulses and control the very land itself.
How could arts like that exist?
Perhaps they pushed against key points in the earth pulses? Like how acupressure can improve a person's blood flow.
That's a rather forced comparison, but you may be right. Either way, those arts have been lost for eons.
I'm impressed, Aizen. You know a lot about everything.
Not at all. There's so much I don't know. For example, the name of these flowers. That's why I travel. To learn.
Aldina alabaster grass.
That's the name of this flower?
Yes. A long time ago, my brother showed me a picture of it in one of his books. They're fragile flowers. They die quickly on their own. But if enough of them gather together, they can survive. Fields of them form beautiful white carpets of flowers. In some cultures, they symbolize kinship. The bonds between people.
Kinship? Huh.
I'll remember that. You and your brother taught me something new today.
I'll never forget either.
What are these items I keep picking up? There's a fishing thing. Oh, that would legit drop it down to 5. How about that? All right.
Here! This is the Earth Pulse point I've been feeling!
No Therian and no barrier.
I must have gotten it wrong again.
I wouldn't be so sure of that. That dragon could well have broken its barrier. Or it might have been too powerful for the Abbey to subdue.
You could be right. After all, dragons make for the strongest demons.
The problem is, we don't know if it's a Therian or not.
Yeah. Let's stick with the plan and head to Stonebury to gather more information.
Am I the only one here who thinks the real problem is how we're supposed to fight a frickin' dragon?
They practically made me go up here for nothing. ...28 hours. And still going strong.
Alright, if I were a Bloodwing, where would I be?
We'll start at the inn. It only makes sense.
I'm just gonna take some of your shit here, you cool? Alright, cool.
Raspberries, strawberries, blueberries... ...they all grow in abundance around Stonebury. We even have a fairy tale about it. One day, the ground was covered with so many fallen berries, they all became stones.
Stoneberries? Is that how the town got its name?
The spelling has changed some, but yes. Berries are an important part of this village. We harvest local berries to make jams, pastries, gels, and all sorts of sweets.
Berry-flavored gels! I've never had one.
We've exported our jam and fruit for a while now, but our raspberry gels are still being perfected.
Aw, rats!
Are the vegetables growing in that field special too? I don't think I've ever seen anything like them before.
You've got sharp eyes. But that's right. They're a rare species of wild potato. They're red and they're called radish bells. We discovered them in the mountains nearby. Sadly, the potatoes are actually highly poisonous.
Really? They look so good.
They do, but the skin and the sprouts are toxic. If you aren't careful when removing them, it's poisonville for you. Deadly poison aside, they're sweet, fluffy, and go great with butter. And when they're fried nice and crispy, they're the best.
So just skin them and sell them. What's the problem?
Yes, we've thought of that, but the way they are now, you have to peel off quite a bit before you get to the edible part. Peel one as big as your fist, and all you get for your trouble is a bit of meat the size of an egg yolk. That's why we're selectively breeding them. One day, they'll have only a thin layer of poisonous skin.
Why not breed them to get rid of the poison altogether?
With no poison, bugs will eat them, and they'll be more vulnerable to cold and heat. With potatoes, as with people, getting rid of everything harmful isn't always for the best.
Why does she sound so sexual? Like, throughout that entire speech, I was turned on. That's no bullshit. Excuse me while I rummage through your fields. Hey, I told you not to step on the crops. Well, guess what, bitch?
Yay! I found so many blueberries!
What are you gonna do with all those? Make jam?
I'm going to feed them to my chickens. That way they'll lay eggs with purple yolks!
What? You know that won't work, right?
It sure will. The color of yolks change depending on what a hen eats. My grandma taught me that.
Actually, we always feed our chickens corn. Is that why their yolks are yellow? What are you gonna do with purple eggs anyway?
Tourists are coming from the capital again, right? I bet they've never seen purple eggs, so I figure I could sell them for a lot. Maybe I can even make our village famous!
You've thought this out. But will they really sell? You know what they'd make, right? Purple fried eggs, purple omelets, purple egg fried rice.
That sounds like green eggs and ham from Dr. Seuss, doesn't it?
Omelet? Strange things sell, right?
You don't have to be so mean just because you can't think of a better idea. Oh, sorry. Here, let me help you.
Fine.
Go catch a whole barrel full of jewel beetles. If we feed them to my chickens, we'll get eggs with yolks like shining jewels. I really wouldn't want to be your chickens, but... okay.
What a carefree village.
But you know, this is what really makes humanity amazing to me. Attempting the impossible. Reaching for the stars, just as a matter of course.
Aye. Though we may stumble countless times on our way, we can achieve anything we put our minds to.
Attempting the impossible, huh?
That's all well and good, but there are some lines that should never be crossed. Purple eggs. Blech.
water around here is ideal for producing wine and spirits. I've been thinking about fermenting something new.
What will you make? This region's specialty is berries, so a berry wine?
But the chilly air and level of humidity here should be just right for making an amber draft, don't you think?
Considering the geography around here, the water must contain a high mineral content. If you use it to make a rice wine, the taste will be unique.
I've considered all those options, but I must create something that can surpass my greatest rival, Sleeping Princess.
But that's nearly impossible to make.
Exactly. Not an easy task, to say the least. Sleeping Princess is made by filling an emerald cask with water from an enchanted mountain spring and sitting it in direct sunlight for 7 years. The water's magic causes it to change color each year. When it reaches the same deep green hue of the cask, it's ready.
Solar fermenting, huh? It won't be easy to surpass a marvel of the winemaking world like Sleeping Princess.
True, but I've finally found it. The ultimate stone.
A gemstone? Will you make a cask from it?
That would just make it an imitation. No. What I found can only be called a natural rock filter.
You're filtering wine with a rock?
Deep in the heart of these mountains, I found a stone that absorbs liquids. I tried using it to filter a berry wine. The taste of it was unbelievably crisp and bright. It preserved the luscious richness of the berries, while adding a clarity that left me breathless. I call it Pure Land Wine. There is no better.
May I have a taste?
My apologies, but it took me 10 years to make a single thimbleful. I drank that thimbleful for my tasting. It'll be about 50 years before I can make a decent batch. I doubt I'll see a full bottle in my lifetime.
50 years, huh? Meet you back here, then?
I've never been so glad not to be human.
Take a good look. You need...
Stoneberry hasn't had much luck growing just yet, but this pioneer town has a lot of potential. Trees grow well here, and the lumber is of great quality. Oh, we're also close to the quarries, so stone isn't a problem. As long as the demons are contained, this country will rebuild. The need for stone and lumber will soar. Best of all, this area is quiet, has beautiful lakes, and is a perfect place for a craftsman like me to work.
And why settle for anything less?
I do feel that you might be a bit short-handed here. It's hard to build without manpower.
You're right. We need something to attract new settlers. Maybe some sort of specialty item?
Is there any fruit or vegetable that can only be found around here?
There is a type of potato called the radish bell that we grow. But it's got a few, quirks.
If you want to attract people, you should just ring a bell. Come to Stoneberry, where the money grows on trees.
A bell tower, huh? That might actually work. We can even use local stones for the bell. The Stoneberry Stone Belfry.
It won't work.
Huh?
Try hitting a rock. Doesn't ring.
Ah, how could I have missed that? I'm still such a novice. My master taught me better than this. Think before you build. That's what he always said. I need to do better and not sully his name.
Oh, wait. I gotta get my reward. Blank.
I was on my way home from a trip to Logres, crossing the Aldina Plains, when I saw it. Rain was pouring as if from buckets, and the wind was so strong I could hardly stay on my feet. From the vast darkness of the sky, a monster of tremendous size descended, like the essence of the storm itself.
A huge flying demon?
At that moment, a group of exorcists leapt out from their hiding spots and began to battle the demon beast. But it met their swords with its fearsome horns, and a swipe of its tail threw the noble exorcist back.
Horns? And a tail?
Where did the demon go?
I couldn't tell you. I was so frightened, I ran away and never looked back. I hope the Abbey can get rid of it, but the beast took out three exorcists with a single blow. Come to think of it, another person was there too. He faced the demon and told it to stop.
Zavid.
If you're going to the Aldina Plains, you'd better be careful.
But we had already went through that.
Zavid.
Well, hello, sailor.
Are you waiting for someone?
Nope. Just saying a prayer for someone.
Someone?
Let's go. Clearly, there aren't any Bloodwings here.
You're just going to leave? I'm right here.
Everybody has times they need to be alone.
Fee.
Right, coming. What do you think he was praying about?
Well, for one thing, he was drinking a bottle of Thorny Forest.
Oh my! The drink you share with your special someone when you're going to be married for life! How romantic!
But getting your hands on that stuff is no small feat. I can only hope I'll get a chance to taste it someday.
That must have had an important meaning for Zavid. That's why you left him alone.
Don't read too much into it.
You're Velvet, right? You must be the one who's seen the demon we're after. We saw a big snake-looking dragon fly over on the way here. Is that what you saw too?
Yes, that's the one. It nests at the top of the mountain in Aldina Plains.
We went to look ourselves. No dragon.
It only returns to its nest on rainy days.
Rainy days, you say?
Oh, just look at what you went and made the weather gods do! This doesn't bode well. Not at all!
Thanks. We'll give it another shot.
A meeting like this must be providence, Meow.
We're in a hurry. Save it, cats.
All the better, Meow. I've just stumbled upon a perfectly nifty piece of stone just for you.
What's it for? That's not a geoboard, is it?
Bingo! I dug it out of some ruins, Meow. They were made by Norman Meowney years ago for surfing along Earth pulses, but I can't use it, so I figured I'd pawn it off on someone else who could, Meow.
Wait, Norman made this? That doesn't exactly inspire confidence.
Don't be so mean! We're capable of exceptional things! sometimes. When a Norman speaks their own name, the fort springs to life and whisks its masters away at top speed. They'll even plow right through weak demons. You can say it's our masterwork, even if we sorta stumbled on it by accident.
Huh. Well, then I apologize.
So we can ride this as long as we have Bianfu with us, right?
Well, kind of.
Do you have to use your true name to activate it?
Not my true name, no. My Norman name.
Wouldn't that just be Bianfu?
No. Norman have a separate name that goes something like Norman so-and-so. It's almost more a title than a name. Often the name has something to do with what they're good at. Something like Attack, or Chain, or Aqua.
Right. You could say names like Bianfu and Grimoire are more like stage names. I actually don't know Bianfu's Norman name, but I can't wait to find out.
What is your name, Bianfu?
Come on, out with it. We're in a hurry.
Norman Brave.
Whoa, look at that!
Wait, Bianfu.
Your Norman name is Brave?
That is so deliciously absurd!
Why do you think I've never told you before, Herbie?
At least the board works, Meow.
And if we get on this board, it'll move us around?
Well, about that. The board propels itself by pushing against Earth Pulse flows. To do that, the board needs information on the flows. But this one here's a completely blank slate, Meow. First, you need to find the geotrees in each area. They serve as a conduit between the surface land and the Earth Pulses, Meow. Once you've actually located a geotree, you can record that area's Earth Pulse data into your geoboard, Meow.
Got it.
This area's geotree is right over there, Meow.
All right then. So long as we find more geotrees, we'll be able to use the geoboard to travel much more quickly.
I was wondering when the gang was going to give us this. So at around 28 hours in, you get your Geo Board.
That's going to come in handy.
Yeah, and it's a lot of fun to ride, too.
I can get used to this.
I'm so worn out. I feel like I had to sprint the whole way here.
Huh. Seems like operating the board saps a lot of energy from Bianfu.
Even still, this board gives us a strategic advantage. Brave here will just have to bear a little exertion now and then.
Yeah, Brave. Buck up.
I believe in you. Be brave.
Ah! Stop calling me that!
Oh no.
And just check out how much malevolence it's putting out.
Which means it's not a Therian.
Let's retreat. We've got no reason to pick a fight with something we can't handle.
I do.
Huh, you're up for it?
What? What are you doing?
She's right. Fighting this creature is a good way to end up dead.
Sorry.
Well, no turning back now.
I can't help but feel like I'm scripted to lose this one.
Damn it, this wasn't part of the plan.
Yeah, but training like this doesn't come around every day.
Be on your guard. One wrong move and you're done for.
I know, that's the fun part. This one definitely puts up a better fight than your average demon.
Is there any hope of actually defeating this thing?
I'll do whatever it takes. That's my way. Sabine!
Yeah. I see you're out for blood. Didn't you, Aizen? Out of my way.
What? Are you protecting the dragon?
She's not a dragon!
Huh?
Back off, or I'll make you back off.
Away.
That hurts, babe. Here, we hadn't seen each other in so long.
Hold it. Is that dragon someone you knew?
I told you, she's not a dragon.
Check out my pecs, and the dragon have some kind of close ties. Did I hear you right? We're talking about a dragon here.
I know what I said, but how could that be?
When Malakim are tainted by malevolence, a dragon is what ultimately results.
So you're saying that dragon was a Malak Zavid once knew?
She must be who he was praying for back in town.
Yeah, most likely.
Do Malakim put out malevolence like humans do?
No. Not by themselves, they don't. But if one remains in contact with humans or demons who do, it will eventually taint her, and she will become a dragon.
What about you, kiddo? You feel anything weird after you got thrown into the Earth Pulse at the Empyrean's throne?
I did, yeah.
Can't say I'm surprised. The air there was thick with malevolence being sent on its way to Enominat.
If I'd stayed there, I might be a dragon, too.
Is having a vessel not enough to prevent a Malak from transforming?
A vessel can reduce the effect, but not eliminate it. By stripping their Malakim of consciousness, the Abbey exorcists seem to be able to inhibit the transformation. But nothing in this world is guaranteed.
Can a dragon ever be changed back into a Moloch?
Nope. Just like with demons, there's no going back.
Do they still hold on to some part of who they were?
You saw that dragon. What do you think?
Well, that's...
But Zavid still won't kill it. Must be his creed at work.
Aizen, listen. Whatever business you and Zavid have with that dragon, I don't care. Do what you have to. But I won't tolerate you getting the rest of us involved in it again. Do I make myself clear?
You've got it.
Good. Now, let's get back to the Therian hunt. We'll regroup in Titania.
If what Aizen said is true, then could I wind up as a dragon someday? Or Aizen too?
I don't know.
Thank you.